I'll just tell you why pyroelectronics is so important, and how pyroelectronics can be used to extract the power from the solar cell and how to feed it to the grid. Okay. Before that, I will just tell you some of the popular quotes that came in IEEE papers. Okay. This is what it is. We now live in a truly global society, in a highly automated industrial front, with economic competitiveness of nations. In future, two technologies will dominate. It was somewhere in 2001 or 2002, IEEE industrial electronics, computers and power electronics. The former providing the intelligence as to what to do, and the latter the means to do it. So power electronics is being compared with computers. And I can't think of life without computers. So now it is up to you to comprehend as to why it is so important. Okay, name any equipment, you will find a small power electronic equipment there. Name any equipment, modern equipment, you will find a small power conversion equipment. Okay. Second one, modern computers, communication and electronic systems get their lifeblood from power electronics. Another very strong statement. Modern computers, communication and electronics get their lifeblood from power electronics. And finally, third, there are large number, third, solid state electronics is the first, solid state electronics brought in the first electronic revolution, whereas solid state power electronics brought in the second electronic revolution. Okay. Yeah. Let's see, why is power electronics so important? Now let us talk about energy, everyone talks about energy conservation. Afterwards, I'll come why it is for solar. Globally, 87% of energy from fossil fuels, 66% from nuclear, remaining from renewables. World has limited fuel. Yes, it was projected. It is projected. Don't ask me whether these figures are right or wrong. Let us not ask. Okay, it doesn't matter. Okay, oil is expected. Someone said in the morning also, oil is expected to last in the for 50 years. Oil for. Oil for 100 years, natural gas for 150 years, and coal for 200 years. The question that is being asked is, the wheels of civilization, will it come to a halt at the end of 22nd century? It doesn't matter. None of us will be around to see whether it is right or wrong. But we owe one thing for the generation to come. What is that? We have to make a better place to live for the generation to come. What we can do? Extend this period. Okay. For that, what do we need to do? Reduce the per capita consumption. Sorry, what do we do? Conserve it or use it efficiently. Okay, fine. See, I just give a small figure. Power, steam input, whatever, all that input power that is consumed. Bulk of the load is either fan or pump type of loads. Fan or a pump type of loads where load characteristics is proportional to square of the speed. TL, load torque, is proportional to square of the speed. Bulk of the loads are of this type, fans and pumps. Okay. Of course, lighting is very small. So see the losses. If 100% is the input here, bulk majority of the losses at the generating end, at the seam. And finally, when it comes here, it's only, what is the input, what is it remaining? Hardly 16.3, 100 is the input, 1 is the input, hardly 16.3% is remaining. So majority of the loss at the input side. So why, when the majority of the losses are at the input side, why worry about saving at the load end? So my answer to you is, if I try to save 1 kilowatt here, I will try to save 6 kilowatt of energy at the input. If I try to save 1 kilowatt input at the, 1 kilowatt of energy here at the load end, I am saving 6 kilowatt of fuel at the input. Okay. So input of 100 kilowatt of fuel energy, output is around 22 kilowatt of useful. Why spend much effort on motor or whatever the equipment when the loss are at the front end? Answer is, every kilowatt of loss saved in the process drive, 6 kilowatt of fuel energy is saved on the front end. Can we, yeah. Can power be renewables? Yes, solar. Use electric energy very efficiently, increase the conversion efficiency. It is estimated that 15% to 20% of electricity consumption can be saved by extensive use of power electronics, 15 to 20, 50%. Okay. See, I said bulk of the power is being consumed by electric motors, majority of them are induction motors, okay, majority of them are induction motors, and these are constant speed motors, okay. Variation of speed from no load to full load is approximately very small. The variation of, what is the variation of speed of induction machine from no load to full load? Slip is of the order of 3%. No load slip is 0.75, full load slip is 3% for a small motor. For a high power motor, it is still less. Still less. From no load, full load slip could be of the order of 1.5 to 1.75%. So, for all practical purposes, for an engineer, all the motors are constant speed motors. Okay. Now, I said bulk of the load is either fan or a pump. Okay. Wherein TL is proportional to, TL is proportional to square of the speed. Okay. You want to, suppose having said that, I want to control the air delivered or the water delivered discharge. How do I control it? How do I control it? By throttling. Throttling. Okay. By throttling, I may be able to control the output discharge. But then what am I doing? Input power to the motor remains approximately constant. It does not change. There is no significant change in the input. You may be able to get the output. So, there is practically there is no savings. Practically there is no saving. Okay. So, see here, TL is proportional to omega square, therefore power is proportional to omega cube. Power cube. So, if the ratio of W1 to W2 it is, if it is half, if I want to reduce the discharge, so P1 by P2 is 1 over 8. This is the third law of affinity, that is what they say. Okay. Are you with me? So, if I want to vary the control the discharge, I can throttle it, there is no input, there is no reduction in the input power. Another one is, how can I reduce the discharge of a pump? Another one is reduce the speed itself, reduce the speed itself or speed of rotation of the fan itself. Unfortunately, these are constant speed motors, constant speed machines. So I need to, only one thing is, yes, I have to change the speed of rotation itself. How do I do it? That is the problem. Most of them, speed of the machines are determined by the supply frequency itself. I need to change the frequency of the supply that I am feeding to the motor. Okay. I think one question that I want to ask you, we have been told that, say for example, induction machine, for a fan type of load, there is a very wide variation in speed. Speed does change over a wide range. Are you with me? Just change over a wide range. Frequency, I am not changing the frequency. Frequency is still 50 hertz. Are you with me? Therefore, synchronous speed has not changed. But then fan speed does change. When I keep it in minimum speed, it rotates at a very, very low speed. So, what must be happening? We have been told that S times the input is dissipated as heat. S times the rotor input is dissipated as heat. That is the induction machine theory. Speed does change over a wide range. Why? According to me, if this theory is correct, it is a highly inefficient operation. Why? If that is true, why fans are so popular? Why fans are so popular? Why fans are so popular? If S times the input is dissipated as heat, and I know that speed does change over a wide range here, fan will be blowing hot air when I keep it in one, but it does blow cold air. What must be happening? Why the fans are so popular? Why the fans are so popular? As per this theory, it is a very highly inefficient operation, highly inefficient operation. S times the input is dissipated as heat, S is the slip, synchronous speed is constant, I am not doing anything to the supply frequency, but speed is worrying. What is the reason? What is the reason? What is the reason? You may be changing, reducing the voltage, fine, but the synchronous speed is determined by the supply frequency. Synchronous speed is determined by the supply frequency. I have not changed the supply frequency, therefore synchronous speed has remained constant. Speed is varying. Rotor speed at full speed, it rotates at a very high speed, and at low speed, at low speed slip is very high. So S times the input is dissipated as heat, and see the number of fans that are installed in a high rise building. What could be the power loss in the rotor? How do we save power? Where are we doing pulse width modulation? We are not doing pulse width modulation. We are not doing pulse width modulation. Yeah, load torque is reduced. S times, yes, here is everything is right. S times the input is dissipated as heat, but then at low speeds, input to the motor itself has come down. Another thing is, what are we doing? As this gentleman said, we are keeping the frequency constant, voltage has reduced. So what is happening in the machine? What is happening in the machine? V is equal to E, that is equal to 4.44 F into phi m into n. This is a very popular equation. Okay. I have reduced V, frequency is held constant. So therefore, which quantity will come down? Flux will come down. If flux comes down, what happens to the core losses? Reduces. Constant losses are coming down. So if the constant losses are itself are changing, so therefore, there is a possibility that you can operate the fan at a maximum efficiency condition. Maximum efficiency condition is constant losses is equal to variable losses. So it's all this possible because of the power electronics. So you need to know the theory. So core losses remains constant. So that's what, this is the theory. Yeah, all of you know maybe why, when I think when I put on the air conditioner, or when the refrigerator turns on, there is a momentarily reduction in the intensity of the bulb. That is because of the inrush current. Okay. What are the various consequences because of the inrush current? There is a voltage dip, maybe. Another one is life of the cable stress, because that current has to flow through the cable. Another one is that current has to flow through a transformer also. Okay. Life of the machine also comes down. How can I address all these problems? How do I reduce the inrush current? Soft. What do you mean by soft starting? Soft starting in the sense I need to apply a low voltage, as well as I need to reduce the frequency itself. Somehow I need to have a frequency converter. So in Japan or in the US, 70% of the air conditioners use variable speed operation. 70% of the air conditioners use variable speed application. So they have addressed all the limitations. Of course, your initial investment has gone down. My another question to you that I am asking is, why today all of us are, when it comes to solar, why all of us are asking DC to DC conversion and DC to AC conversion and MPPT? Talk to any person who is working on solar system side, he will say that you need to have a DC to DC converter and then again a DC to AC converter and an MPPT. Any one system, these are the three parts are there. All of us are saying the same thing. Is it possible for us to take a different route? Are you with me? In what context I'm talking? There is a saying, if all of us are saying the same thing, in fact nobody is saying anything. Why there is no different school of thought? Why can't we use directly DC energy that is available from the solar? Take any equipment, that AC we are getting is converted into DC. convert it into, and again maybe take in a computer, a laptop, okay. That's what I said, variable air conditioners. Now 70% of use a variable speed. Variable speed means AC to DC and again DC to AC. Future lighting is, people say it is LED lighting, where it requires a very low voltage, low voltage DC. Okay. This fan should have been replaced by permanent magnet, long back. I do not know, we have not replaced so far for various reasons. If that happens, there is a significant saving in energy in the fan. Okay. Again, there is a AC to DC conversion. So take any equipment you see, this AC is being converted into DC. So if I am having my own generation, one panel in the rooftop, why do I need to convert this DC to AC, transmit it, and again back to DC? Why is this? Can't we think differently and can't we use this energy a bit more efficiently? See the problem, DC to DC conversion, DC to AC conversion, again, AC to DC conversion, three stages of conversion. Can I do it with one stage of conversion? Overall efficiency is neta 1 into neta 2 into neta 3. Three stages of conversion. Can I avoid it and have only one stage of conversion? I'm asking you that question. Please give a hard thought. Don't like everyone, like everyone else, let us not talk about DC to DC, DC to AC, MPPT, something different. Okay. Another thing is, I want to make my product very compact, lightweight. How do I make? I do not know. I think most of you might have tried to lift a regulated power supply in the lab. Three amperes, 30 volts. What is the total wattage? 3 into 30, 180 watts. What is the weight of that power supply? And all of us might have lifted that PC, a Pentium PC, which is, we have it on a table. There the power supply could be of the order of 275 to 300 watts, 250 to. Why it is so light and why the regulated power supply that we are using in the lab and why it is so heavy? See, any technology that has to be popular, it has to be lightweight and it has to be compact. Are you with me? It has to be lightweight, it has to be compact. I'll just give an example. The inverter, I'm from a small village, we have a small inverter, 300 VA inverter. I find it a bit heavy. But I saw the other day one small advertisement, 600 VA inverter, a person is holding that inverter in his palm. Why it is so light and why the inverter which is being used or which is sold in the rural areas, why it is so heavy? What could be the reason? The major component there is a 50 hertz transformer. So if your product is to be lightweighted, you cannot use or you cannot operate the magnetics at 50 hertz. You have to operate the magnetics at a very high frequency, very high frequency. Same thing here, see here. V is equal to 4.44 F into I, so V into I is the VA rating. 4.4. For a given VA rating, VI, how do I reduce? N tends to, as F increases, N comes down. So as N comes down, copper and therefore the size comes down. Yeah, but then what price that I have to pay? What price that I have to pay? What price that I have to at what price? Whatever that you do in life, you have to pay a price. Nothing comes for free. As frequency increases, what happens? Core losses increases. So for a very high frequency, I don't think we can use the conventional which core? Ferrite core. We may have to use going for air core. The moment I use air core, what will happen? Two coils are coupled through air as a medium, my leakage increases. Coupling coefficient of coupling comes on, leakage increases. So now I have to take care about the leakage flux. These are the issues we have to address. How to address, we will find out as we go along. Okay. So high frequency conversion is always desirable. Yeah, I have a transmission line. Fine. Suppose I have a high power solar inverter. I have to feed the power to the grid. What do I do? What are the precautions that I need to take care? Forget about the finer details. What are the precautions? What do we need to do? I have a 1 megawatt solar power inverter. I have to connect it to the grid. What are issues? Synchronization, in the sense, yes, we all of us synchronize our generator to the grid by adjusting the frequency of rotation. Now, what do we do here in the, for the inverter? I have to connect that inverter to the grid. And mind you, generator output voltage is fairly sinusoidal. Are you with me? Generator induced voltage is fairly sinusoidal. Inverter output voltage cannot be a sinusoidal. It could be a square wave as well. How do I connect this 1 megawatt inverter or whatever the power that is there? How do I connect it to the grid? What do I need to do? What did you do when we connect the generator to the grid? Phase sequence is right. Okay, frequency and then magnitude of voltage. In the inverter, what all things? Something similar concepts are here. What do I do? What all things are required? How do I ensure that inverter frequency as well as the grid frequency is the same? How do I ensure? I will ask you these questions. I will not answer this as we go along. Let's see whether we'll find an answer or not. On Friday evening, let us see, we'll try to find answer to most of these questions. One way is, I have to feed this 1 megawatt power to the grid. What do I do? What all precautions do I need to take care? Another question is that 1 megawatt inverter is already installed there. Solar insulation is low or evening time, okay? Can I do something now? Can I use this inverter for some other purpose? Because solar insulation is low. Afternoon time, there are solar insulation was full. Inverter was supplying 1 megawatt power to the grid. Evening time or in the night time, do I allow this inverter to remain idle, or can I use it for some other purpose? See, in the night time, what happens is all the loads are coming to the grid. Most of the loads are inductive in nature. Except for lighting, most of the loads are inductive in nature. Ayana? Yes. Okay. So therefore, transmission line or our distribution network is loaded by a highly inductive loads. What happens? Voltage falls. That's the reason, if you are from a rural area, you know the life there. The fluorescent lamp does not glow when it's supposed to glow. It glows maybe around 2 o'clock in the night or something. In the around 7 to 9 o'clock, it will not glow because voltage is so low. How can I improve this? How can I improve the voltage in the at the far end of the transmission or distribution network?
It's leaning power control of capacitor.
No, no, no. One second. If you use a capacitor, what will happen? If I use a capacitor, what will happen? See the problem here? I connect a capacitor. Okay? I said in the when the system is highly loaded, voltage at this point comes down. You all agree, isn't it? For it. At that time, system requires a high leading current. When the voltage is low, it requires high leading current. But then when the voltage is low, capacitor IC is V divided by XC. So as the voltage comes down, leading current supplied by the capacitor also comes down. But then system requires a higher current. Basically, this is the reason capacitor is also known as an unreliable friend. When the system wants more leading current, it can't supply. But then I have an inverter here which supplies 1 megawatt to the grid during normal insolation. Now in the evening there is no sunlight, okay, grid requires leading current or reactive power support. My question to you is, can I use this inverter to supply leading current to the grid? See, that is the question that I am asking. See, I just can't install 1 megawatt inverter, and see in monsoon there is no sun at all. Can I try to get some revenue from the utilities for supplying leading current? Or during over voltages, suppose the transmission line voltage is high. Now what do I need to do? Lightly load condition voltage could be high. So I have to what do I need to do? Yeah, I need to connect an inductor. Draw Q. Can I use this inverter to draw Q instead of connecting a separate inductor? See, these are the questions that I am asking. Okay, we will see. Yeah, if you talk to any power system man, he will say transmission line, AC lines, transmissions are fully loaded, you can't add extra power. Most of the lines are loaded. Now you are installing wind farm, you are installing solar power. What is the effect on the grid? Can I arbitrarily set up a power plant and connect a power to the grid? It is already overloaded. What do we do? You follow what I am saying? You just can't install a high power solar plant, or you can't install a high wind farm, because you have to extract the power and feed it to the grid. There has to be a transmission line. These transmission lines are loaded. Unfortunately, the power flowing through a transmission line is determined by voltage at two ends and the angular displacement between them, V1, V2 divided by X into sine delta. Delta cannot be, though theoretical value is 90 degrees, this delta is of the order of 30 degrees. You can't schedule the power in AC line. You cannot. Are you with me? You can't say so much of megawatt of power has to flow through this line. It is completely determined by the circuit conditions. Voltage at two ends, angular displacement is fixed around 30 degrees divided by the reactance. And you are setting up a power plant there. What do we do? Can I use my power electronics to improve the power that is flowing through the transmission line? Okay, it may be all related to so these are the questions that I asked. So that's what. Is it possible to increase the power through the line securely without affecting it? Okay, energy from alternative sources, historic energy, simple. Our forefathers used wind power, wind, and those days, our forefathers. Now we are using so called today's energy scenario is use oil, coal and nuclear, and future energy sources say that again renewables. Looks like wheel is getting completed. Are you with me? Forefathers, how did, what they use? They used wind power, wind hydro, okay, looks like. And here, see the problem here, solar is DC, yes, it has bulk of the, if I have to feed the power to the grid, it has to be converted to AC, okay. And again, this power has to be connected to the grid, there are synchronizing issues, line may be overloaded. Wind power, as the speed of the wind changes, what happens? The rate at which the rotor is being rotated in the magnetic field also changes, therefore voltage induced as well as the frequency changes. Come on, as the speed changes, frequency changes, voltage also changes. Grid requires constant voltage and constant frequency. Constant frequency. What do I do? What do I do? Yeah? Power electrons, I know, but then what? Wind, solar is output is expensive but decreasing. I should not be saying the cost today in solar. This one, anyway, it's a fact. Cheapest environmental clean wind energy now priced more than 31,000 megawatts of power around the world. In India, installed capacity. I don't know about what exactly the power that we are extracting. No data is available. What is the definition and goal of PI? PI electron is a technology associated with efficient conversion and control of electrical power by power semiconductor devices. This is the definition. Okay. And the goal of PI electron is to control the flow of energy from electrical source to electric load. Okay. Okay. This efficient. I said power electronics is being compared with computers, okay. Why it is so popular? Any technology that is very popular, it is two things. Efficiency and reliability should be very high. It has to be, if the conversion efficiency should be as high as possible, and it should be reliable. Size, weight and cost should be low, okay. Everything going. So NETA is a good measure of success of any technology, efficiency. If the moment I say efficiency is high, see, power loss is low, cooling requirement comes down. Are you with me? The moment cooling requirement and packaging density can be increased, size comes down, okay. So how can the circuit change the voltage yet dissipate less power? Yes, dissipate power. Input voltage could be, solar voltage could be low, grid requires 440 at a distribution level, fine, afterwards I can step it up, but yet dissipate low power. How is that possible? What are the circuit elements? Circuit elements, passive circuit element, resistance, inductance and capacitance. If you want to be efficiency should be high, you cannot use resistors. Your solution cannot have a resistive component. It has to be only L and C, okay. Now there are of course active devices. I have transistors, MOSFETs and IGBTs, okay. Power loss in the device in the BJT is VCE into IC, okay. It is minimum during on state power loss is minimum if I saturate the transistor, VC is sat into IC, okay. It should be very low, okay. But then if I saturate it, I may be able to reduce the losses. What happens to the frequency of operation? Come on, wake up. I said to improve the efficiency, we have to reduce the losses here, okay, in the device that are taking place. I can reduce the losses by saturating the BJT, okay. If I saturate the BJT, what price am I paying? Come on. My turn of time increases. Do you know or not? The device is being driven into deep into saturation. We will see sometime later. Turn of time increases. Okay. The moment I turn of time increases, therefore yeah, turn of losses, and I can't increase the frequency of operation. Okay, so there is a problem. If I operate in active state, power losses increases. If I saturate it, yeah, frequency operation comes down. So question that I'm asking, can we take a middle path? Are you with me? Neither operate in active nor in saturation. What is that? Back to active. Come on, if I operate in active, the onset losses are high, isn't it? That's what happens in a linear power supply. Why it is so heavy? Why, what is the heat sink mounted outside there? These heat sinks are not mounted outside in a power supply that is used in a computer. Come on. Am I speaking fast? No, then it's okay. Power supply that is used in a computer, there are no heat sinks are mounted outside. The power supply that is used in a laboratory, heat sinks are mounted outside. So what is my conclusion? There must be a lot of loss are taking place in the lab, but not that many power, that much of power is being waste dissipated there. So it looks like in the regulated power supply, power semiconductor device must be operated in active mode. That's the reason VC into IC is high. This is my conclusion, gut feeling. It could be right or maybe wrong, I don't know. We'll see. But in a computer power supply, I can't see the heat sink outside. Looks like losses are low. So that means device must be operated somewhere, and it is lightweight, not very heavy. So they must be operating at a high frequency. How are they achieving high? We found here that if I saturate the device, I can't operate in saturation. How are they being achieved? Let's see. I have to operate at a very high frequency, I have to reduce the size, okay. But as of now, it is not very clear as to how exactly to do this, because to reduce the heat sink, I have to saturate it. If I saturate it, frequency of operation comes down. Okay, is there a way out? Looks like there is a way out. Yeah, for high efficiency, active elements should be operated either in saturation region or cutoff. In addition, use of only LCN elements input. Okay, this is what it is. This is a simple example that I have given. Input is 30 volts, output is 5 volts. What do I do? Input is 30, output is 5. I can put a resistive network, I square R losses. Or what is being done in the lab? VDC is 25, output is 5. Rest of the voltage I will drop across this BJT. Or I will use switch mode power conversion. I will try to reduce the average voltage applied to the load. Initially, I will apply full voltage, and after some time, I'll apply a zero voltage. Okay. Yeah. So power electronics. See, that's the reason why it is so popular. Just extensively used in motor drives, power supplies, lighting, high frequency induction heating, electric welding, active filters, bulk power transmission. Okay. Electric vehicles. To process from power from non-conventional energy source, and we are here, okay, and most of them are interrelated, okay. And why it is so popular? Power electronics progress is primarily due to the advances in power semiconductor devices. Fast devices are available. That is the reason there is a significant improvement or advances in power electronics, in power electronics. Coupled with fast processors, cost of power process, dedicated chips, circuit configuration, control and estimated. So if you say that I am working in power electronics, you should be reasonably good in almost all the areas in electrical engineering. You need to have good circuit theory, okay. Then circuit theory, fast semiconductor devices, how to operate those fast semiconductor devices. So I need to know a little bit of analog and digital, Are you with me? I need to operate that switch. So, analog and digital, control theory, and fast process, again digital. So, little bit of everything is there in power electronics. Yeah, these are the significant events in the history of power electronics. The concept of volta came in 1783. First rectification in 1830, rectification effect of copper oxide. Selenium rectifier, 1876. 1896, single phase rectifier bridge, 1896, more than 115 years. Still that circuit is so popular. I don't think anyone can ever challenge this circuit, single phase bridge. Single phase bridge, so popular. That's the reason, let us think differently. Can we use this solar energy in a different way? Let us not take the same path, DC to DC, DC to AC, MPPT. Let us not split our hair in all this. People, let us not walk the same old path that people have walked. We will take a different path. We may land in a ditch or we may land in a, I'm telling you, you take a chance, okay, and it is worth it. And I am here to push you to take a different path, not the same path. 1897, three phase bridge circuit. 1901, invention of glass mercury rectifier. 1848, invention of transistor. 1948, so this became first industrial revolution, and they said power electronics brought in the second industrial revolution. That's what it is. 1953, germanium power diode. 1954, silicon power diode. 1957, thyristors. Okay, now thyristor up to 6 point blocking, we can block the voltage up to 6.5 kV. They are available as of now. It can block one device blocking 6.5 kV, one device. Yeah, a little bit of, I'll start with power semiconductor devices. If you have any questions, feel free. Let's have a dialogue, not monologue. Feel free. Why there is pin drop silence? What's the problem? I'm not going to do anything. Say something, no problem, anyone. Any questions? Any counter views? Feel free. Sir? Nothing. Don't take or no point having a dialogue, something. What is that? Go ahead. Any questions? Yeah, now I'll start with power semiconductor devices. Okay, what are the important characteristics we need to know, and how to operate them? We will see. Okay, today and tomorrow. Okay, power semiconductor devices is the heart and soul of modern power electronic, and is used as switches. Okay, it's used as switches. What is the property of an ideal switch? What's the property of an ideal switch? Fine, in the sense it should be able to block any voltage, should be able to carry any current. Onset losses are zero, offset losses are also zero. Okay, onset and offset losses are zero both. When switch is open, it should be zero. Okay, it should be able to withstand any voltage across it. This is an ideal switch, but then it has power dissipated in the switch when is off or on, both should be zero. That's the condition. Okay, so basically operation is along this graph. On state, turn on time should be as small, zero. Ideal switch, turn on time should be zero, turn off time is also zero. Okay, voltage across the device, when it is on it is zero, and current flowing through the device when it is off it is zero. So basically this is the path, and basically it is, therefore it is unstable. Okay, so characteristics of the device are practically very close to the ideal switches. Off state current is not equal to zero, but then a very small current that flows when the transistor is on. When its transistor is off, a very small current does flow. Okay, and when the transistor is on, voltage across it is very small, but definitely it is not equal to zero. Power loss in off state and on state is not equal to zero. T on is not equal to 0, T off is also not equal to 0. It takes a finite time to switch from on state to off to another. Therefore, the switching losses. Switching losses occur when it is turned off, current has to flow, current has to fall down to 0, and voltage across it rises from 0, a very low value to the supply voltage. So the product V and I is finite. V and I is finite. That is dissipated as heat. Okay. Power cut. So therefore, there is a power loss, so heat sink is required, cooling requirement. Okay. So what are the different types of power semiconductor devices? Basically, there are three types. One is controlled devices, one is uncontrolled, and third one is semi-controlled. Let us not discuss about semi-controlled. We will discuss about controlled devices and uncontrolled devices. Okay. Uncontrolled is basically a two-terminal device. I am talking about only diodes, and I am telling you why this is very important. What are the important parameters that you need to consider while designing an inverter? What are the important parameters that are required in a BJT while designing in a DC to DC converter or a DC to AC converter? One is very obvious, average current. And what is second? What is the second important parameter that you need to? It is the voltage that it should withstand. Okay, it depends on the circuit topology. Okay, in the sense, suppose I am using a full wave rectification. What is the voltage rating? Send it up. This is V, this is also V, this is also V. What is the voltage rating of this? What is the voltage it has to block? What is the voltage this also block? Or fine, in the sense, I will just see here. What is the voltage rating of this diode? What is the voltage rating of this diode, and what is the voltage rating of this diode? It is V here, it is 2V here, 2V here, 2V here. Because capacitors in the positive of capacitors charge to V in the negative, when this voltage reverses, voltage across the diode is 2V. So you need to be very careful in the circuit topology, input as well as output. Both cases are important. What voltage the diode has to withstand. Another important device that is being used in DC to DC and low power DC to AC is MOSFET. Okay. Very popular in DC to DC. It's used in low power, low voltage inverters as well, MOSFETs. Okay. Generally, low voltage, high current device. MOSFET is metal oxide semiconductor field effect transistor. Fast device is a majority carrier device. What about BJT? BJT is basically a minority carrier device. Okay. Fine. By the way, if you see here the structure here, gate, source, and the drain. Okay. We have N plus P and again a N structure. Are you with me? N, P, and again an N. So if I start from source and if I reach drain, both there are two diodes connected back to back. I start from source, reach the drain, it's a PN. And again, NP, two diodes connected back to back. How is the conduction possible? There are two, if I see the structure here, there is N plus, NP and again PN. N plus and N minus indicates that it is highly doped and it is lightly doped. Where is the N itself? This is the P and PN. How is the conduction possible? How is the conduction possible? Both two diodes are connected back to back. It appears as though there cannot be any flow between drain to source. How the conduction is possible? What is the limitation? Why BJTs are were replaced by maybe MOSFETs, or why BJTs are not being used now? What is the problem? What is the problem with the BJT? Basically, it is a current control device. Are you with me? It's a basically a current control device. What happens? The so-called gain as the power rating increases. As the power rating increases, what happens to the gain, or what happens to HFE? HFE is maybe high for a small transistor. SL100 gain may be very high. Okay. Suppose a power transistor. What is the gain? Gain is low. Gain is low. A 8 ampere BJT gain could be of the order of 10 to 12. 8 ampere BJT gain is of the order of 10 to 12. So how much is, what is the IB that is required? What is the IB that is required to turn on the BJT? See here the problem. 8 ampere BJT HFE could be of the order of 10 to 12. How do I reduce the turn on time of a BJT? How do I reduce the turn on time of a BJT? I will give a high pulse current. That current is could be of the order of 1.5 times the steady state current. Okay, 1.5 times the steady state current. So 8 amperes BJT HFE is of the order of 10 to 12. Okay, so IB at steady state, a base current could be of the order of 1 ampere. Okay, 1 ampere could be of the order of 1 ampere, and during starting I need to give a 50% high current. So current is could be of the order of 1.5 amperes. Every time when I turn on, current could be of the order of 1.5 amperes. Okay, so basically it is not a small signal transistor. I can't use a SL100 to drive this transistor. So I require a small power transistor to drive another power transistor. You got the problem? Because basically it's a current control device. So I can't use a small signal current transistor to drive this. I need to have one small power transistor to drive another power transistor. So what about the MOSFET? MOSFET is a voltage control device. I said here two diodes are connected back to back. So looks like there is no flow between DSN possible. Okay. But then here there is a SiO2 layer. I think something similar to? Yeah, capacitor with a different epsilon r or whatever. Okay, so when I apply a suitable voltage between gate to source, what happens? Okay, gate is insulated from rest of the device, no steady state current, only displacement current like a parallel plate capacitor. Okay, so when you apply a suitable voltage here, a channel is formed. I say a channel is formed and current starts flowing from drain to source. A channel. The moment I say channel, okay, it can be a bidirectional flow. Water is flowing through a pipe or flowing through a channel. I can reverse the direction of flow. So MOSFET is basically a bidirectional device. Depending on it, the way you bias it. Unlike a BJT. IC is always positive. IC is always positive. Here I can, so the when the MOSFET is conducting and is on, okay, a channel is basically, it behaves like a purely resistive element, purely resistive element. So you can reverse the direction of flow, of current. So you don't need to use a separate MOSFET to reverse the direction of current. One MOSFET is sufficient. It depends on how you drive it. Are you with me? So, is a basically a voltage control device. Voltage control device, no steady state current. So, turn on time depends on the rate at which you charge the gate to source capacitance. Remember, the turn on time depends on the rate at which you charge the gate to source capacitance. See, that's the problem. I'll repeat it. It depends on the rate at which you charge the capacitance between gate to source. How do I first charge it at a minimum possible time, sir? I want to charge this capacitor the minimum possible time. What do I do? Huh? It's a RC circuit. I have to charge it as well. What do I do? R should be the moment if I make R zero. What price you need to pay? The initial pulse current, so it's a give and take. So to reduce the turn on time, I need to reduce the charging. That R, if I reduce R, that source has to supply the peak current. So during is the ohmic. This is the region where we operate in power electronic equipment. Only a losses here. This is an active mode. Okay, power. See, another advantage in BJT is you can try to reduce the on state losses by saturating it. By saturating the BJT, you can try to reduce the on state losses. MOSFET, once it starts conducting, it behaves like a channel, and it is on state losses are I square into RDS on. It is not VC sat into IC. It is ID squared into RDS on. So on state losses are slightly higher in a MOSFET compared to a BJT. But then MOSFET is a, you require a very low gate power to drive it. So that is the advantage. Okay. Yeah, at the on state channel, the resistance bear like a resistance RDS on is delta S by delta ID. So BJT has a substantially lower voltage drop than a MOSFET. Another thing is while operating a device, you need to always ensure that you have to operate in something known as a safe operating area. Safe operating area. For a BJT, there is four parts, whereas for MOSFET, there are only three zones. One is limited by voltage, current, junction temperature. In a BJT, there is a fourth zone, what is known as the secondary breakdown. That is secondary breakdown is resistance the resistance coefficient is in a BJT is negative, whereas in a MOSFET it is positive. What happens if the resistance coefficient is negative? Temperature, if it, look, so as the temperature increases, resistance decreases. So what happens? So thermal runaway will happen. So it is basically difficult to parallel it, okay? And that is because of the reason there is what is known as a secondary breakdown in a BJT. Whereas in a MOSFET, it is a positive temperature coefficient. So paralleling is easy, okay? And therefore the secondary breakdown region is also absent in a MOSFET. So these are the three areas. Secondary breakdown region is completely absent. AB is drain current at a steady state. CD is the maximum BDS drop that the device can sustain. BC is the maximum power dissipation imposed by RDS on. Okay, paralleling is. Yeah, these are the various parasitic capacitance. Main important is drain to source. Drain to source is the most important parameter. This parameter, this capacitance, you need to know while designing your gate drive circuit. How exactly to design a gate drive circuit? What are the issues? I don't know whether I'll cover this now, but then we will be covering in your final lecture in December in classes. So looks like BJT has certain advantages. MOSFET has certain advantages. What could be an ideal device? What could be an ideal device? What are the advantages of BJT? On-state losses are low. On-state losses are low. Okay. What is the advantage of? But then what is the limitation there? Yeah, it is a current control device. Current control device. Okay. So therefore, base drive requirements are high. Base drive requirement high. What about MOSFET? MOSFET is a voltage control device. Gate power requirement is less. Gate power requirement is less. But then RDS on is high. What could be an ideal device? Ideal device may be best of. Looks like I can combine. Or can we combine the best of MOSFET as well as best of BJT? So IGBT insulated gate bipolar transistor, insulated gate bipolar transistor. Input is MOS, output is BJT. Output is, that is known as IGBT device. Yeah, maybe tomorrow we will start. I'll do that. I'll do discuss diodes as well. Then maybe other important devices that we are using in DC to DC as well as DC to AC. Yeah, that's about it today. If you have any questions, feel free.
You told the MOSFET is bidirectional. Is it both the way it is controllable, or one way it will not be uncontrollable?
No, controllable. You have to apply the proper gate signal. Okay. Gate signal.
But most of the characteristics only lie in the first quadrant only.
Yeah, that's the reason. In the sense, if you want to reverse the direction, like in a, I do not, I will do it tomorrow, or suppose in a buck converter. Basically buck converter DC to DC, basically I have a diode here and a switch, isn't it? How does IL change in this? What is the wave? How does IL look like? What is the minimum value of IL? Minimum value of IL is 0. Are you with me? Okay. Now if I replace this diode by a MOSFET, I can make that current IL to be negative. I can make the IL to be negative. This current linearly increases, say, then I can reverse the current also. It's possible if I use a MOSFET. Is it a MOSFET? How it, we will see, I'll explain to you. It's possible. So my performance of the buck converter improves if I do this. Synchronous converter.
Sir, in the grid connected system, suppose if that grid is turned off, but if the photovoltaic energy is being transmitted, if anyone is working on the other side, he may get electrocuted. No, how will you avoid this problem?
I don't know. Say that again.
See, if anyone is working on that EB line.
See, I know. I can understand. These are the issues to be addressed. These are the issues to be addressed.
So the backflow will be there. No. Backflow will be there. No.
No, in the sense, these are the issues to be addressed. These are the major concerns. Whether the standards on what?
There is a domestic user wants to pump power to the grid.
Yeah.
So still there are no standards for that.
Standards in India may not be there, but then it is a normal, this one in the US or in Germany or in Australia. Users do feed in the power to the grid.
No, a domestic user?
Domestic user. Yeah, I can, but it's possible. But then it is not yet come to our country, maybe it will come soon. Which one? Yeah, but then where in India it is not applicable so far? Where do we have the system where a single user feeding small amount of power to the grid? Standards are there, international standards are there. IS may not, we may not have an IS standard.
In BJT, you mentioned that one power transistor to drive another. Can you please?
I gave a simple example. In the sense, 8 ampere transistor gain is 10 to 11, 10 to 12. So, steady state gain is of the order of 1 ampere. Are you with me? Okay. But to reduce the turn on time, I would need to pump in a slightly higher current, maybe 50%. So around 1.5 times that is required. Again, see these ratings are at 25 degrees. 40 degrees again, I have to derate it. You follow what I am saying? All these ratings are, data sheets are at 25 degrees. What is the normal ambient? You design a product for 40 degrees, that's minimum maybe, okay. So again all this HFE will reduce. So steady state IB that may be required is of the order of 1.5 amperes. Can you pump, what is the SL under current rating? 500 milliamperes, 0.5 amperes. So what will you do? So I need to have a 2 ampere BJT to drive a 8 ampere BJT. So I need to have a, that means I need to have a BJT drive, one BJT driver, another BJT. Is a low voltage, high current BJT to drive another. Any other question? Feel free. No? Synchronous converter, I will see tomorrow. I will teach.
Instead of using DC to DC converter from a solar panel output, why not use it direct?
That question that I posed to you people.
But if we use LED lighting, if we use LED lighting, that lighting would not be sufficient, and that may cause some diseases, the emission of that light.
May or you are saying is may cause. Or will?
I have heard that one of the professor was speaking.
No, I do not know in what context that professor was speaking, let me not comment. But then one thing is for sure, future lighting is LED, that's what the literature says. Everywhere.
The fans should be redesigned. No, means the new coming fans should be DC. Fans and all.
That's what I feel. It should be permanent magnet BLDC motor. Yes. That's what I feel. Yeah.
So for the existing one, anyway AC should be used, and for the new fans, the DC fans should be designed. That's what you are telling.
Now, what I am saying is, I do not know how many of you people have travelled in Bombay locomotive. Once upon a time, the fan was not working, you take a comb and rotate and it used to start working. Those are good old days. Now, I think all the fans in Bombay locomotive, in suburban train, they are BLDC fans, brushless DC motor fans, permanent magnet based DC fans. So, it's basically a synchronous machine, synchronous motor. It's a basically a synchronous motor operated in a brushless DC mode. Okay, so you require a DC supply and an inverter. Okay, so what I feel that these fans, highly inefficient fans, should be replaced by this BLDC fans. And if that happens, yes, you require. So most of the loads are. There is a conversion for efficient conversion there is, this AC is converted to DC. So my question to you is, why are we saying the same, or why all of us are singing in the same tune? Can we use this energy directly? No, there are a lot of issues that has to be, see, whatever that you do in life, you have to pay a price. That's what I'm trying to tell. Yes, there are other issues. grounding. Grounding is today, as of now, it is very well defined for AC. Now, standards for DC grounding is, as of now, they are not available. Grounding issues. Then how to handle the capacitance between the panel to the ground? If I use the DC transmission, there are other issues. There are a lot of issues there. But then, unless until we start working, they will not be addressed. Those problems will not be addressed. My question to you is, why can't we directly use DC when there is this AC is being converted to DC? My question to you, it's possible. Should be possible. Should be possible. Especially when you are. When you have your own generation, maybe when you have to transmit the power, yes, because of transformer and all, it is not very convenient. If you are making your own generation, why not? Why not? Yeah, okay, thank you. See you tomorrow.